So first of
Yes,
all, I
of
would like
course.
to
Yes,
thank
it's clearly.
first of all, I would like to thank Professor Evi Kestrin, a member of International Union of Material Reserve Society, to invite me to share with you my concerns about functional materials for a better prosperity for all. I used to say there are no party of science and technology without the materials. What I will try to give you is a glance about the relevancy of functional materials for a broad range of applications, and then I will give you a flavor about what is going on about the the batteries association in Europe, to which I also belong, just to see what are the mandatory steps that are going on here in Europe. Also, I have to say that I'm also a member of the European Research Council, which is the best science council in the world, because we gave and we support globally talents worldwide. So let's start to see what's going on and what we need to do for our world. You see, Siberia is one of the coldest places on the earth, is on fire. The Amazon, one of the wettest places on earth, is on fire. Fires are burning across the planet. We need to act fast. And once we have no planet B, so we have to see what are impacting on the climate changes and what is impacting also in our today's life. And of course, this means that if you want to really to improve and to preserve our planet, we have to create a sustainable and green future, adopting green technology without sacrificing digital growth, which means that we cannot block the comfort and prosperity for the people. It means that we have to act in order to reduce, reuse, and recycle the materials. And of course, the new concept that is ongoing is the circular economy, which is a different concept to move the planet in a greener future. This is a mandatory requirement for all type of research that is ongoing in Europe. So what is our biggest challenge is to reach the zero waste challenge, which means that going from what impacts on the citizens, we want no to food waste, no to water waste, which is something very important, no to biocompatible waste, no to technology waste, which means that we have to reduce, we have to see how we can reincorporate it, the materials that we are using. Therefore, one of the key targets that we have to go when we are trying to develop or to make research is that we have no time for promises. It is time for practice. It means that we have not to make science per se, but science that impacts on the citizens and will impact on our planet. And this means that for sustainability, we have to look for five golden rules. Yes, to green, which means that look for eco-sustainable materials, fully recycled, fully abundant, and which are not toxic when you are trying to make a development. No to waste. So it means that when you go for electronics, for instance, we are creating a lot of e-trash, which means that they are not recyclable, highly difficult to be reutilized. And it means that for the products that impacts on our today's life, we have to look for the recyclability of the materials, besides to look for its abundance and its impact on the environment. Yes, we have to go for circular economy. When you look for this, it means that the three R's is to be achieved. And of course, as we want to tackle all these demands for the citizens, no to high cost products. So it means that we have also to use green technologies, low cost technologies that can be affordable to all. And of course, we have to go for equality, which means that everyone is able to use the technologies, not just the small number of countries. So technologies and comfort should be for all. And this means that the only way to reach this type of target, the idea is to see, to see the world through sustainability, environment, and economy. This is our see-through and the progress that we have to go, and they are aligned with what is going on worldwide, and also about the 17 lists what we have to do from United Nations, that I'm very proud to tell you that the Secretary General was re-elected. He's a Portuguese, he's my friend, so I'm very happy to do so. And we are in Europe, not in Brazil, I'm not from Brazil. In Europe, we are demanding for this Green Deal, which is a key factor from the president of the European Union, which means that a zero pollution Europe, a transition for circular economy. We want to go farm to fork, so we have to go all the value chain going from raw materials to the applications. And of course, we have to use green technologies and of course, clean and reliable, affordable energy. In fact, this is the key issue for all these developments. We need energy to make everything running. And of course, if we can do this, it means that when we try to look for this type of applications, we have to see that for all gives us comfort, going from health to communications to transportation, this should be impact on our lives. And it means that when we go to look, we can see the party of our lives that makes all sustainable. The enabler for all the technologies and all the applications are, of course, advanced materials. And what we have to look when we try to select materials is to look for a list where we have to use more non-toxic, biocompatible and biodegradable materials, using low-cost and simple materials processing systems, using more multifunctional materials, using more and more flexible and nanotechnologies that will minimize the product size and so minimize the raw materials expenditures. So this means that we expand the lifetime of using the same type of materials. We need substitution because we have critical materials, and so it means that we have to design new materials behaving like organs. We need what we call steam materials. I'm involved on this type of developments here in Europe. The other thing is when you look for food and we have to see how we can sustain our development, packaging strategy is something that impacts on our lives. We have to design new biodegradable materials for packaging, less garbage. The specific vision of the research work should be to build effective cooperation between science and society, to materialize new smart technology for science, and to pair scientific nobility with social awareness and responsibility. Of course, the sustainability plan that we have in my lab starts from substrates. We use full recyclable substrates going from fibers that we try to functionalize fiber to make smart textiles. We use and we exploit paper as a substrate because it's fully recyclable, is the most abundant biopolymer that we have. And also we go for other biocompatible materials like cork or nanocellulose or biopolymers substrates. The idea is to make everything biocompatible, low cost, flexible, and durable. Then, of course, as far as materials are concerned, we are exploiting materials that can be fully recyclable. And on the front line, because they are much more reliable and reproducible, and they don't suffer of aging effects, we are concentrated in oxides. Oxides at a nanoscale or biopolymers for making organic electronic devices. And moreover, we are fixing more and more for a broad range of applications, carbon fibers, nanocarbons, nanotubes, and graphenized materials that we mainly exploit all of this, not to make active devices, but to develop high conductive tracking, highly transparent at a nanoscale. So this means that we are looking for eco-friendly, multifunctional materials, low cost, and easy to be manipulated and recycled. For instance, silicon is the king of the electronic materials, but it's harder to recycle. We have to use high temperatures above 1200 degrees centigrade, while most of the oxides we can recycle at much lower process temperatures. 300 degrees is more than enough to process materials, or even we can make them at room temperature, which is the best that we can find in a broad range of oxide materials as well as on organic materials. And then, of course, we are exploiting low-cost technologies. So avoid clean room facilities, try to use chemical-based technologies. And for this, we are centered on printing technologies and 3D printing, so we can build up devices and systems at a three scale. We are exploiting laser technologies to transform the surfaces, and so to convert surfaces in active and active devices, which means that we are transfer the complexity of integrity to the complexity of the functions that they can do it. We are in the front line on the development of this type of surfaces in Europe and worldwide. Avira Fortunato won the what is called the Nobel Prize of Engineering due to this type of technique that she introduces, and of course wet chemical processes. And of course, when we try to combine substrates, materials, and technologies, we go for the applications. We go for electronics, energy, health, and packaging. I will try to give you a flavor about what on this type of developments that we have here. And of course, on the electronics, I have to say that we have been on the front edge in developing what we call transparent electronics, that is reliable. And this this was our first contract that we have had with the Samsung, and we have been supported by Samsung. And last year, Elvira Fortunato, due to this idea to promote the transparent electronics using large area surfaces and amorphous surfaces, he got the Horizon Impact Award, the highest prize that we have here in Europe. And with this type of concept, she also won the World Engineering Prize and also the most famous prize in Portugal given to the science. And with this development, because we could make all this technology at room temperature, we could make and turn surfaces smart. And so we could introduce this type of technology, for instance, to control the bottles, to have smart bottles, so we can define the level and temperature threshold detection inside the bottle, as well as the level of bacteria that we start accumulating inside the bottle, so can give you an idea about the lifetime that you can have of the products. Real-time monitoring of biosignals using smart textiles, powered by harvesting energy processes that I will speak later on this presentation. And of course, why flexible electronic? This is a gold opportunity for oxide applications, what we call oxide thin film transitions. And you can see here the evolution, because this is a demand from the people. You can see the main application as far as interfaces to communicate data are concerned. We have the computers, and the computers, the active matrices that are based on active semiconductors in transistors, switching commutations gates. They are, of course, the keys used. And in fact, the production that you can expect is about 300 million per year. And the cost of the integrated circuit is around 100 euros. Then, of course, with the evolution and give comfort to the people, you see we have the smart devices, the smartphones, and you see how it per habitant. You have now 50 billion requirements, and the cost, of course, decreases for of the integrated circuits to $1 to $10. And today, as we want to make everything smart, and we can and we aim to interact with the surfaces to define the state and also to localize them, it means that you have more than 1 trillion of applications and a lot of commodities where you can apply this type of materials, and the flexibility is something very important. And the cost reductions is something that is concerned. We are now the cost per integrated circuits below 1 cent, 10 cents, depending on the type of application. And this is mandatory. And so we have the technologies, the materials that are able to serve this type of application. This is, in fact, a golden opportunity for the oxides. This is a report from FlexLogic, and you can see here, I will not waste too much time. You can see the traditional silica technology, the new generation of silicon, and what is going on and pushed by FlexLogic using organic and inorganic based devices. And you can see the key figure concerns to have costs and the number of integrated circuits around or minimum in the range of 100,000 IC integrated level circuits, which means that the figure of merit is quite important. So it means the response of devices is quite determinant in the selection of the same. And you can see that we are really reaching this objective and getting and making the same type of performances than silicon, but at a much lower cost. And you can see this is something that is impacting today in our lives. One of the key points that has been slowed down the application of these oxides is the difficulty to build up CMOS devices, for which we need to have N-type transistors and P-type transistors with high mobility, with high performances. And very recently, you can see here on this application, we could make the first P-type TFT perovskite-based devices on Kapton. This is on foils, on flexible substrates, so at low temperatures with very high mobilities, which means that we could break one of the limitations in the exploiting CMOS oxide-based technologies. And this will impact, of course, tremendously in our near future. And as we are able also to make all this materials processing at room temperatures, we also are the inventors of what we call the paper electronics. It means that we can functionalize all the paper surfaces, and we can build up inside the battery, we can build up the antenna by graphenizing the paper surface. We can exploit the paper structure to work as a memory. I can promote and to develop circuits, integrated circuits on the surfaces. I can process solar cells, and of course I can storage this energy by using supercapacitors and together with paper. So it means that even I can make it for diagnostic applications. This is a project, a strong project that we are now developing in Europe, where we can make smart diagnostic platforms for detecting, for instance, the coronavirus virus. And this is something that we are inventors. This is something that also give us a lot of reputations. And in 2019, Nature Electronics really promote this type of application. And you can see in August this year, so 2 months from now, a report that Nature did about our targets and our goals. This is something that I pay your attention. And of course, on the paper electronics, we constitute here in Portugal the first collaborative lab involving industry and users for paper electronics. This is called Alma Science. And what we do is really, we try to functionalize the paper. We are making paper, not just to support inks, but for other purposes. And for all of this, we have to develop the inks. We could develop inks using water as solvent. This is something that we won the OLAI, which is the largest conferences about large area electronics. that is held every year in Frankfurt, and we won the innovation prize due to the hinks that we developed for active oxides that are really impressing and make us to give the jump as we need. Of course, when we go speaking about energy, what we have to look is burning natural gas for electricity releases between 0.6 and 2 pounds of CO2 equivalent per kilowatt hour. So it means that we have a problem if we have to reduce the CO2 fingerprint. Coal emits between 1.4 and 3.6 pounds. Wind is responsible for only 0.2 to 0.4 pounds. Solar energy sectors emits between 0.07 to 0.2 pounds. Geothermal energy sectors emits 0.1 to 0.2 pounds. Hydroelectric energy sector emits between 0.1 to 0.5 pounds. So it means that when we are looking for circularity and we are looking for the exploitation on green renewable energy, which is also one of the topics of this conference, we have to look how we can really improve by more than three orders of magnitude the quality of our environment by reducing the CO2 emissions. This is something that, of course, we have to look for. And it means that we have to look for other ways to use the energy, not only the typical photovoltaics as we are looking for, but for instance, to exploit piezoelectricity and try to improve the transformation of mechanical energy and electrical energy, and moreover, how we can also capture the energy that is in the cloud. This is a key area of development that is concerned, and there are several countries that are really promoting this type of development. And this is the number of works that we can found distributed over the world. And you can see that the key players are China, much more than any other sources for using substitutes for the traditional energy sources. I just claimed China. Then you have Brazil, because you know that they are transforming sugarcane. You have this biodiesel. They started some years ago, and this is why they are in the list. But then you have Europe. You can see that Europe is the second player, much lower as in China. But that's why we are promoting this type of activity. And this change of philosophy is also creating jobs worldwide. And you say that more than 11.5 million jobs in 2019 has been created. So one of the things that we have to look is smart energy challenges. And we want energy that is affordable, cheap, sustainable, renewable, green, and clean. And of course, we want to go for flexible energy. On this matters, of course, one of the key roles is the mechano-response energy arster. This is something that we can use. We have the vehicles, we have the cars, we have to walk. And can we try to use this energy for at least for powering most of the energies that of the sensing elements that we can have to control our health, for instance. So we have also thermal energy arsters, and of course the photovoltaic energy arsters that we know. So these are the three main key players that, because we cannot go with a wind turbine associated to our lives, but with this type of smart variable energy arsters, we can do it. And this is something that can push us for the future. In our laboratory, we are mainly concentrated on mechano-response energy arsters and photovoltaic energy arsters. And for this, we could make photovoltaic tiles. This is something that has been ongoing and has been pushed by Tesla as a concept that we developed and we patented. This is the prize that we won 5 years ago in Dubai. And today we have also improved, and we could discover a new architecture to develop the integrated solar cells. And with this, we could more than duplicate the solar cells efficiency. And this is something that has been noticed worldwide. And this paper that we developed, we got so far more than 3.5 million viewers, because this is a revolution. It's really a disruptive concept as a way to promote and to increase the solar energy capture. And it's based on two things. We expand the wavelength spectra of capture, the energy from the sun, by improving the architecture and design of the solar cells. And then we use a multi-junction solar cell. So with this, we really did it. The other thing that also we did some years ago is that we make the first solar cells on paper. So it means that we can make it at room temperature, at very low temperatures. The other thing that we are really developing is this piezoelectric system, where by touching, we can, of course, generate energy, and this energy, you can see, we can have these LEDs to switch on and off as we are just improving the quality. This is something about the voltages and currents that we can really have. And this is something that impacts on our life. The other point is about health. On health, the idea is to make low cost and smart systems. And this, of course, should be always our prime concern. And in this case, we turn to the biotechnology market is improving. Everyone knows this market is very important. We have on this pandemic times, and more, this is something that is going on. And the market is fabulous. We have a market above $30 billion annual. This is something that will stay for some time. And this is not only for sensing our body, but also, of course, to promote the quality. This is a review paper where you could see most of this type of applications that can be done. And of course, something that we can control is the smart packaging. And smart packaging is also a growing market. You can see about $7 billion US dollars. And moreover, as we are going for smart packaging, it means that this is a new era of developments, or all the technologies that I spoke before are impacting. As you can see from what I show you, materials with functionalities are really important, and they impact in different areas. You can see in physics, chemistry, engineering, biology, genetics, because we can even control mathematics, because we need to have, for instance, to exploit machine learning for database to design the materials of the future. And of course, we have always to exploit nanotechnologies, or to reduce as much as we can the raw materials that we require. And then, of course, these are the areas where you can impact. And this is, of course, the path for innovation based on materials where we can exploit their own functionalities. This is a concept that I bring, and in Europe is running, is that science and technology is like a metro station. And we cannot exploit a material or a technology per se, but we have to see how we can exploit it, serving the best of this purpose. The vision of the future research will work like a metro line, where we have crossroads and travelers can move from one line to another. We need new concepts, and this is something that we can bring. And this, of course, brings the relevancy of materials, which are the roots. And we have the fruits, which are the applications from which we can make of these materials. And just before concluding, I would like to show you and where the materials are on activators, the battery actions at Europe. The great targets that we have in Europe is Europe is aims to be the first carbon neutral continent until 2050. Batteries and clean energy storage are needed for reaching this target, and battery value chain is mandatory. So we have to go for all the value chains. And this is some numbers that you can see that are forcing inside Europe concepts with the energy. You can see how we can reduce and how we can impact. And despite the COVID-19 pandemic, electric mobility has been increasing. Europe is a plug-in vehicles made up 10.5% of the market compared to only 3% in 2019. So it has been growing the number of electric cars in Europe, and the batteries for electrical vehicles accounts for 5.4% of passenger car sales in the European market. This is the target for in 5 years time from now, while plug-in hybrids reach 5.1% of the market. So the idea is that in 5 years time from now, we can reach values in the range of 10% of cars required for European transportations. And this means that if this is the targets, and if you want, we have to have, of course, the best value chains going from the raw materials to the add values that we can increase, and looking for what are the mandatory points that we need is lithium, how we can improve the storage capacity. We cannot change lithium. It's absolutely crazy to change lithium because it's the lightest material that we have in the world. And the lightest one is hydrogen. No one is a solid made of hydrogen. So it means that we have to exploit different ways of exploiting lithium and connections with lithium, aiming to enhance the storage capacity of the cars. And this, of course, we can make it the batteries lighter than they are today. And of course, this is a key rule for to use. And of course, when we are using materials, we have to think always on the reuse and the recycling of the batteries of the future. So the sustainability systems of batteries in Europe, we have to go from responsible sourcing of materials. We have to select the materials that are eco-sustainable, sustainable manufacturing and circular design. So it means that we have to see what are the energy that is required to make and to fabricate the batteries, and what is the payback period of this demand of the batteries that we do. And of course, we have to look for repair, reuse, and recycle of the batteries. And the responsibility of sourcing for raw materials globally. So we have to see how we can exploit lithium, how we can make the value chain going from the raw materials, look for the toxicity of the materials, diligence for regulations about environmental impacts, and to see how we can really bring together by life cycling analysis of all this component. So those are in fact the targets of research in Europe in this area. And of course, as I said before, we have to look for low carbon batteries. So when we are trying to exploit, and we know, and the vehicles itself, we are always, as I said at beginning, we have some type of CO2 contamination. And of course, the idea is to see how also we can capture and reuse and try to avoid strong contamination, because of course we are reducing several times, but of course the life cycle analysis is something that is very important, like the reuse and the recycling of the batteries. And I just have to say, the when we are looking at the batteries, there are three materials that we use and we exploit: is cobalt, nickel, and copper. And we want to reuse and reutilize 95% of this that is used in batteries. We are looking for substitutes for cobalt and nickel. And of course, this means that substitution design of new structures is a key factor of research in the field of batteries that we are putting together with what I call the STEM materials for the progress of our society. Together, of course, with trying to use different architectures that will impact on the sustainability of the vehicle. And maybe the batteries cannot be the cube as we are and that we know. Maybe we have to transform and try to use in a more expanded way. This is some type of architecture that we are thinking in this field. Before finishing, this is a bench of public of books that we published so far until today. Some of them connected to solar energy, and some of them connected to the exploitation of these new materials. That is a glancy if you want to look of them. Moreover, I'm also the editor in chief of a new journal which is called Discover Materials that has been launched by Nature Group. And the idea of this Discover Materials is just what I just finished to explain. We try to see how materials, how we can discover new functionalities, make new architectures to impact on our society. So if you have crazy ideas, please use Discover Materials to present your data. And let me finish by thanks to my group. And we have this, and we use this African proverb. If you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. So come together for a better world and a global impact on our society. Thank you very much to all of you to listen to me, and I'm open to answer to the questions that we have. Thank you very much.